Today, we shall prepare ourselves with some algebra needed to understand even the statement of Van Kampen's theorem. This algebra of groups. So some little group theory we have to do. Let us start with an indexing set lambda by a diagram. This is a technical term now, okay? So it consists of, it's not just, it does have an ordinary sense of a diagram also, but now I'm going to define the diagram of groups and homomorphisms. Index over lambda. So this consists of a number of, you know, data here. A collection of groups Gi, okay, since I is inside lambda. These are groups. A collection of homomorphisms, each from Gi to G. So there's a unique group G here without any suffix here, alpha of Gi to G. Okay. And a collection of homomorphisms, eta ij. So these are now double indexed from Gij to Gi. So Gi's are also some groups such that alpha I composite eta ij equal to alpha j composite eta ij. So you can come from Gij to Gi and then go to G in two different ways. So they should commute whenever I is not equal to j. So all these data is there. Such a thing is called a diagram of groups. Okay, you can say all of them defining over G. G is the one which is fixed. These things are varying here. Gi, Gij's and so on. And lambda itself may be varying. Okay. Such a diagram, G, Gi, alpha I, Gij, eta ij. These are all. This is called a push-out diagram. So it has to satisfy some more condition. Namely, if for each diagram, suppose you take another diagram like this, the same indexing set, but groups and homomorphisms are different. G prime, Gi, Gi prime, alpha I prime, Gij, zeta ij. Okay. Then there exists a unique homomorphism gamma from G to G prime such that gamma composite alpha I equal to alpha I from R. Okay. So this is similar to the push-out diagrams, but it looks like more data is there. And the arrows are all reversed here. So that was a pullback diagrams. And this is push-out. In categorical language, this push-out diagram is an initial object. For every other G prime, there's a map from G to G prime, which making all these diagrams coming. Let me look at this case carefully again. So let us take a simpler case which you may be able to understand easily. Namely, suppose all the Gij's are the trivial group. Then this data is obvious. All eta ij's have to be trivial. This condition is also trivial. So C goes away, only the collection of Gi with the homomorphism from Gi to G remain. Okay, that is a special case. Then the push-out diagram will be called a free product. Okay, free product of this family. So free product of a family corresponds to a group G along with homomorphisms from Gi to G, satisfying some universal property. For every other such collection, this G will admit a map homomorphism from G to the new G primes, making all those various diagrams commutative. So that is the definition of free product. For a free product, we will have a neat notation. In other words, a pushout diagram is an initial object in the appropriate category. Since category I have not emphasized, you can just keep it in your memory box and so on. Given a collection of groups and homomorphisms, eta ij, the problem is to determine the existence and uniqueness of this pushout. Suppose you are given only this data. Can you construct a G and alpha is on this way, which will satisfy this pushout? Okay. Uniqueness is something which is easy. Namely, if there is a G like this and G prime like this, you will get a unique map like this, but reverse this one, you will get a unique map this way. The composite will be an identity because G to G identity map will be there already, which satisfies it. By uniqueness of this one, this composite, this back to this one must be identity. So this becomes an isomorphism. Such that diagram is commutative. That is the uniqueness of the pushout. Uniqueness of every kind of this one, which is defined by this kind of universal properties, is built in the definition itself, and it's easy to verify that. It's just like in the case of fiber product, we have seen that this is. But the harder part is the existence. So you'll see that the existence of this one is much, much harder than the pullback. The pullback was an easy case. An important observation is that the defining homomorphism alpha j from gj to g, in the case of pre-product, they all become monomorphisms. In the case of free product means what? Again, I recall that this part is absent. This is trivial group here. So you don't have to write anything here. What I want to say is, when star of GI that exists, okay, let us assume that exists, the homomorphisms will be already there in the structure. Alpha i's and alpha j's from each GI. These will be all monomorphisms. That means they are injective homomorphisms. You see, you don't know what this G is, how this G looks like, and so on. But you can determine quite a few things by the definition. It has to be like this, it must be like this, it must satisfy like this, and so on. And that is helps, that those things help finally to locate what exactly it is, namely to construct this one. So let us see why these alphas are injective. Okay. So to see this, fix an index j, take g prime equal to gj, and alpha I prime equal from gi to gj, I have defined to be the identity homomorphism if I is equal to j, and the trivial homomorphism I is not equal to j. Okay, so what I am doing, I am forcing some extra information from this one by choosing this one to be one of the GJ. Put this one here and take this as identity map. Take all these for I not equal to J, J is fixed, all these varying, this map to be homomorphism to be trivial homomorphism. Obviously, with this data, and there is no, this is identity here, this part is identity. Okay, once you have this, there must be a unique map here, unique homomorphism. The unique homomorphism here, such that this composite, this is identity, means what? This must be injective. Over. If there is homomorphism here, so this composite, this is identity map. That's what I have taken identity map now. Then this must be injective. In fact, this becomes a retract. This is stronger than just injectivity. There is a map from G to here, back here, G prime. This G prime is GJ. Is that is coming this identity is retracted. Okay. So this observation helps a little bit in guessing how to construct a free product. So I told him this free product is in some sense it's a minimal thing. It should contain all these groups, the given groups. And it should have this property of extending any kind of homomorphism defined on all these different groups to a unique homomorphism. So this is the kind of criteria what we have observed in the space of vector spaces, free abelian groups and so on, if you remember. Vector space is definitely you remember. Therefore, we would like to have this one, think of this one as some kind of group generated by all these various groups. The group relations within each of these groups should be maintained and nothing more, no further relations. That is why the word free product comes in. This is a general idea, but this is hardly a proof. This can't be a proof. Because we know what is the meaning of generation only when we have a group. Right? So this part we have to take care of it. And that is where the free words come into picture. So what we do is, the special case is simpler, namely the free product case, we will first prove the existence there. Okay? Then, with a little bit of work, we will complete the existence of pushouts in general case. Okay? The proof of the existence of pushout will be presented in two stages. First stage is, you take up simpler case of the existence of free products. Then we shall derive the existence of pushouts without much effort. Okay? So let us restate the definition of free product a little more carefully, because all these eta ij's are there, they were not necessary. So let us make it. What you have is a collection of groups indexed by an indexing set. The free product of this collection is a group together with a collection of homomorphisms. I am now denoting it as eta I, because I know finally they are going to be inclusion maps, okay, of some kind, monomorphisms, G I to G, such that I am not assuming that they are inclusion maps, because I don't know what G is. Eta I from G to G, such that the following universal property holds. For every group H and a collection of homomorphism F I from G I to H, there exists a unique homomorphism phi from G to H, such that when you compose it with eta I, phi composite eta I is given Fi. So that is the meaning of that this F, this phi is an extension of all the Fi's. So this is the definition. Okay. So let us look at existence, uniqueness we have already seen. Let us look at existence, and existence is by, again, construction. Not just there exists something, okay, by construction. So go through these new concepts carefully. Let us take any set S. Okay? You may, just for the sake of definiteness, let us, you can assume that S is non-empty. By a free word in S, we just mean a finite sequence of elements of S. Okay? Each element of S is identified with a singleton sequence. This is just convention. So that when I write S belongs to S, it also belongs to the sequence in that of length 1. Elements of S will be called alphabets. And these sequences will be called free words. Okay? Therefore, an alphabet is also a word. A word of what? Length one. You can say this K is the length of this. Okay? The set of all free words in S, let us have a notation. We'll have W hat of S. Okay, W for words, but W hat is for free words. We include the empty sequence also, just for sake of carefully. If S could have been empty, then sequences, there are no sequences of elements there. So empty sequence also it should allow. Okay, and this empty sequence becomes the hero. We will see how. Okay. Given two free words, S1, S2, Sk, S1 prime, S2 prime, SL prime. So these S1s, SIs and S primes are elements of S. These are sequences of length K and length L something. We can define a sequence of length K plus L by just juxtaposing the two sequences. SS prime is a new sequence of length K plus L. The first K elements are of S, later on it is S primes. So this K plus 1th element is S1 prime, S2 prime and so on, SL primes. Okay. So this is the definition of composition. So I am defining a binary operation on W hat. Two finite sequences are there. The juxtaposing, you see another finite sequence. Of course, the length will increase, no problem. Okay? I want to complete the definition. What is the juxtaposing empty sequence? S empty is the same thing as S. Empty S is also empty as S. This is true for all S, where S is a sequence. Therefore, you see, for this binary operation, this empty sequence becomes a two-sided identity. So this is very important for us. This makes the W hat into a semigroup. What is a semigroup? A set with an associative binary operation together with an element which is a two-sided identity. That's all. Okay, the associativity of juxtaposing is obvious. You can put the bracket here and then write another one, or first put the bracket this way and take the left part here. So that part is okay. Okay, it's completely obvious. Just like the associativity of composition of functions. So we shall write, when I say S is a sequence, Sj will be the jth entry. Okay, this is just a temporary convention. Okay, again I want to tell you that an alphabet, which is an element of this capital S, is also a word. What is it? It's a word of length one, namely S equal to sequence S bracket, if you put that bracket. Okay. Okay, now suppose we are given a family of groups GI. This was all general thing about any set S. Now I am coming to the construction of free product. Start with a family of groups GI. Just take S to be the disjoint union of all these GIs. Okay, so that is my alphabet now. Look at W hat of that. So this time I will not write S at all here. This S is understood here. What is this S? It's a disjoint union of GIs. Okay. Take all sequences of finite sequences in this letter. They are alphabets. And it has a binary operation. Okay. Its two-sided identity is the empty sequence. All right. Now we go ahead. We don't have a group structure yet. It is only semi-groups. Universes don't make sense here. So we want to introduce an equivalence relation here. Okay, inside W hat. So before that, I have to go step by step. So I define what is the meaning of elementary collapsing. We say S prime, which is another sequence, is obtained by S by an elementary collapsing, which I write it as S collapses to S prime. If S prime is obtained by one of the following two operations. What are these two operations? There is some J such that the jth entry is the identity element of one of the groups. Remember, S is the union of all the GIs. The identity element in each group has a different element, after all, in this group. These are disjoint union. But I am just writing just one for all of them. Okay. I should write 1, comma I or something, indexed by I, to show that it is in the group GI. Okay, whatever it is, suppose the jth element happens to be 1. Okay, in the group operations, this 1 has no role to play. 1 into G, G into 1. So we want to just drop it. That is what we are doing. Okay. Identity element of some G, then we delete this entry from S to obtain S prime. When you delete it, the length of sequence becomes one less. So this is the operation of collapsing. Okay, there's another way I can collapse, namely, suppose for some J, the jth entry and the j plus 1th entry are in the same group. One of the groups, namely G1, G2, GI, whatever, I don't know which one. But they must be in the same group. Then I combine them using the group law inside that group. They are two elements of same group. They are occurring consecutive. So you combine them. So two entries become one single entry. Combine and put it there. So these collapsings, elementary collapsings, each time they reduce the length of the word. Okay. So these two operations I have defined now. Out of this, I cook up a equivalence relation. How? These operations are non-symmetric, you see, right? They are not even reflexive also. So you have to just make them reflexive and symmetric by inverting them. So we say S is equal to S prime. If there exists a finite sequence, say S is S1, S2, Sn, these are not elements now. They are all sequences. Okay. The last sequence is S prime. Okay. So what is the relation? This sequence of sequences. S is the first sequence of words. S2 is another one. What is the relation? S2 can be got by S1 by an elementary collapsing, or S1 can be got by S2 by elementary collapsing. Collapsing could be this way or this way. Okay, so that is the meaning. Sk plus 1 is collapse to Sk, or Sk is collapse to Sk plus 1. This should happen for each consecutive elements here. Then we say Sc is equivalent to S prime. Now it is easy to see that this is an equivalence relation. Okay. Here are some examples of how it things like. Suppose there is a sequence like this one, singleton one. That one could be one of any group, any of the group GIs. What do? I drop it. So I get an empty sequence. Suppose G and G prime, both G and G prime are in the same group GI. Then I combine them and get GG prime. This is length 2, this is length 1. Okay. Suppose I have 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. This should be equivalent to empty sequence because go on doing collapsing, collapsing, collapsing n times. Finally, you will be left with empty sequence. Suppose I have AB, B inverse, A inverse. What do? I have to combine B and B inverse by this notation. They are in the same group, right? B and B inverse are in the same group. So combine them. What I get? BB inverse is identity of that group. Drop it. Then what do I have? A and A inverse. Again, I have to combine them. They may be in a different group. Doesn't matter. Again, they produce one of that group. So drop it. So finally, I get empty. So these are some easy examples of what we are doing with these words, free words. They are no longer, when you go modulo this one, they are also free words, but they are more restricted, okay? So you have canceled out certain things. That is the point here. We shall denote the equivalence classes of S. For example, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 is the same thing as empty sequence. A, B, A inverse, B inverse, same thing as empty sequence, right? Like that. Equivalence classes of this one, putting a bracket. Take a sequence, put a bracket means it's an equivalence class. All of them are in one that way. With a simplification notation, we don't want to put any bracket for the empty sequence. Okay, empty word is just represented like that. The set of these equivalence classes of words should be denoted by bracket W. Remember what was W hat? You started with unions, disjoint union of all the groups. Then we took all the free words in it. Then we took equivalence classes, and that is this bracket W. It's also clear that if S collapses to S prime, you multiply means what? Juxtaposing it by a sequence T, then ST collapses to S prime T because collapsing is happening inside S. Similarly, TS will collapse to TS prime. Okay, so juxtaposing either on the left or right preserves this collapsing. Therefore, it preserves the equivalence relation also. Therefore, the binary operation goes down to bracket W under equivalence relations. The binary operation can be defined now because it respects the equivalence, these equivalence classes. I can define bracket S into bracket S prime to be bracket of SS prime. You choose any representative. Representatives may be different here. The right hand side will be well defined. SS prime is not well defined. Bracket SS prime is well defined. Okay. And you can check that the empty sequence box with S is same thing as the box of the equivalence class of just S, right, on either side. Therefore, the empty sequence plays the role of two-sided identity on this binary operation on bracket W. Okay? So, in particular, bracket W will be also a semigroup. What we want to see is there is more here now. What is that? Now, let us do that. Suppose you have a sequence S, which you can write as x1, x2, xk. I have just changed the notation for here. You can put S1, S2, Sk, doesn't matter. Inverse word, I will define S1 inverse, S inverse is inverses of this one taken in the opposite order, xk inverse, etc., x1 inverse. What are these inverses? Remember, each gi is a group. Each xi is in some group, some gj, okay? So, inverse makes sense there. And that inverse will be another element. So, it is another alphabet. So, this is a sequence again, and this is an element of W hat. All right? And if you combine S and S inverse, follow S by S inverse, this is not an empty sequence, okay? But it is equivalent to an empty sequence. Why? Because look at this one, S1, S2, Sk, followed by Sk inverse. So I'm canceling out Sk and Sk inverse because I have to combine these two, get identity, drop it. Next, combine, identity, drop it, and so on, you get this one. Similarly, if I put S inverse S. Okay, therefore, when you take the brackets, bracket S prime is nothing but the empty sequence. So what we have done is, we have actually shown that bracket W is a group under this operation. It was not, if you take the free words, it was not. After equivalence relation, it becomes a group. Okay? Therefore, W together with F multiplication becomes a group. Construction of regroups is over. However, it takes some more time and effort to see that this is actually the free group that we are looking for. Namely, it satisfies what? It satisfies the universal property that we have to prove. We have just constructed something. Okay? That will take some time, which we will do next time.